We are starting. Members of our discussion, which is titled Financial Infrastructure of Economic Growth, are somehow distributed. Some of them are here at this stage, and some of them are sitting in the first row just because of space limitation. With your permission, to save time, I will not make this one-by-one introduction. Moreover, you know these people, or at least most of them. But I will introduce them while giving them the floor or asking questions. As traditionally, when we have just an expert discussion, I will start with one question addressed to all participants of our expert discussion. It's well known that a financial infrastructure is good and acceptable if it is able to fulfill several functions, good conduct. Activity, good transmission. When financial institutions carry out transactions efficiently, conveniently for clients at acceptable price. So when everybody is pleased with the current situation, when a financial structure is able to accumulate and to keep savings. Savings can be kept under mattresses as well. But if the population prefers a financial institution, it's better. And thirdly, a financial infrastructure or financial structure should be able to identify risks and to implement risks. I think these are the three key attributes of a good financial infrastructure. And next is the question, the existing financial infrastructure of the Russian Federation and financial infrastructure of global markets. Does it satisfy these requirements? Does they have such attributes? Or something must be and could be improved? So I am expecting from you brief answers and some comments. And we will go clockwise. So I will be the first. Well, it's extremely difficult to give a brief answer to your question. I don't think that a financial infrastructure will ever be perfect because there are risks, there are risk appetites, and this will always serve as a kind of limitation. So we should not expect a perfect financial infrastructure, but whether it's contributing to the economic development or not, it's a different point of view. So you don't want to give any evaluation to Russian infrastructure. I think that Russian infrastructure matches the level of economic development. Of course, it's not perfect, it's not excellent, because our economic development is not perfect. We can say that it's a kind of Moiseev matryoshka doll economy, and inside this economy we have a financial infrastructure. Actually, I never said perfect. I was using good, but good or bad, it are very subjective notions, what is good and what is bad, is the title of a well-known poem, and even this poem for children does not give the final answer. So I don't want to give my subjective evaluation. I think that we should not be ashamed to compare ourselves with well-developed markets. We have underwent several international surveys and appraisals, but of course there are some hot spots that require immediate solutions, such as external audit or legal framework, and what I'll say I should mention especially is the liability or punishment for abuse of powers in the financial sector. I would split our infrastructure into four parts. The one is, let's say, collecting savings. The second one is a segment or a part that provides objects for investments. The third part is in between them, so it's an intermediary between savings and securities. And the fourth part is the, let's say, the punisher. I think that we have equal development of all four parts. So everything which is, let's say, related to the circulation of securities is already well mastered. And when let's say, Russian Ministry of Finance, which managed to issue euro bonds without euro clear and sell it to foreign investors, that's really a world-beating record. Speaking about infrastructures and let's say infrastructures related to the issue of securities, to the legal framework, leave much to be desired. To add, when we speak about a collection of money, the main achievement of the system is the ongoing confidence of a population to the system, despite recent financial crisis. And say even after the central bank started the sanation of the system and revoked licenses from hundreds of banks, we didn't experience any Russian banks, and we still have the same percentage of savings of deposits or retail deposits in our banks. And at the second half of last year, we saw say some vitalization on the stock market, but there are objective measurement tools to measure financial infrastructure. Europe, about 3 years ago, for 1 million of persons, there were 480 banking outlets. In Russia, this figure made about 270, and with the sanation of the banking system, this figure is still went down, which means that by the end of last year, by 1 million persons, there are 200 banking outlets. But Maybe also the number of banking outlets in Europe is too high, but still, I believe that this retail banking structure is underdeveloped. About 40% of Europe. Europeans, by the end of last year, were connected to internet banking or mobile banking. Well, average figures are not very descriptive because it can be 60% in Scandinavian countries and 20% elsewhere. But in Russia, this figure made 30%, which means that, I'll say, 30% of our population using banking services were also using internet banking or mobile banking. And the rate of penetration is making from 8 to 10% per year, which allows me to conclude that with the same rate of development in a couple of years, let's say the number of banking outlets will go up, and the number of internet bank users will also go up, and we will match European indicators, both by the rate of penetration of internet banking and by the scope of provided services. That's to answer your question about the a transmission mechanism and, I'll say, savings. If I speak about risks, I do admit that there are risks both for retail market and for corporate market. But let's say, once again, if we compare ourselves to European countries, we can just conclude that risks are everywhere. Now, I just will repeat my question to Ekaterina, who joined us recently. So, we are comparing Russian financial infrastructure and the global financial infrastructure, and I suggest to compare these two by three characteristics. It's the transmission mechanisms, or let's say, the speaking about the convenience and efficiency of transaction, ability to save money, to hold deposits, and risks. This is a subjective assessment. So, from your point of view, Russian infrastructure compared to the global one, is it good or is it awful? But I will ask you later. Gabriel Di Bello is the head of Monetary Fund Moscow office.
The question, and thanks very much for the invitation to participate in this great panel. The first thing that I would say is you posed a very nice question, and basically what you do is you try to put Russia in the context of international trends. And in that sense, what I would say is that Russia is fully integrated into international trends in what respects the banking sector and the financial markets more generally. And in this sense, what I would say is I would divide developments in two. I would just point out that since the global financial crisis, there has been a lot of attention paid to regulation or supervision of what actually were the causes of the problems that led into the crisis, into a global financial crisis. And this has led a lot of work in the context of the G20, in the context that has been led by the Financial Stability Board, by the IMF in cases, by the BIS. And so we have learned lots about why the world faced this financial crisis. And in this context, Russia was, I think, a participant, of course, through the G20 in these discussions. And very timely, we had what is called the Financial Sector Assessment Program in 2011, where a number of shortcomings were identified at that point. But at the same time, just last year, we had another financial sector assessment program. And for those that do not know, this type of program is a work that is done together between the IMF and the World Bank and try to analyze systemic problems in the financial system, try to analyze whether there is a consistency or not of the system and the analysis with the core Basel principles and analyzes whether there is consistent or not with Yosko principles. So a very deep and painstaking analysis of the system. And what we found is that there are lots of progress in the Russian financial system, in the way it is regulated, in the resiliency of the financial system and banks vis-a-vis crisis. So what I would say to give a more macro perspective to your question, what I would say is that Russia is fully integrated, is deemed a systemically important financial center, and that what we observe in terms of the trends in the last 5 years is that many of the lessons that arise from the global financial crisis have been and are being implemented in Russia. At the same time, and I'm going to reserve for the discussion later on, there are some things that can be done, and there are some things in particular that can be done to strengthen the link between financial sector development and economic growth.
Спасибо. Ну, передаю слово Нилу Осборну. Нил много лет руководил компанией Евромани. Это журнал, это публикация, которая хорошо знакома в России и во всем мире. Сегодня Нил возглавляет, и он председатель, chairman, компании Thoburns. Это компания по investor relations и так далее. Ну, это может быть не важно, потому что мы все его хорошо знаем. Пожалуйста, тоже вот такой вопрос.
Thank you, Dr. Vyugin. From a foreign perspective, I think a number of things stand out. And one is that
Единственное, что я хочу сказать, это то, что российская финансовая структура была удивительно устойчивая за последние пару лет, несмотря на то, что были санкции, а может быть, из-за них и она была очень здоровой, и уже замминистра сказал, что был триумфальное, так сказать, предложение евробондов, и не было возможности остановить этот процент. И госпожа Набиуллина и команда Центрального банка замечательно провели работу в плане укрепления банковской системы, консолидации ее и управление плохими долгами и улучшение работы с кредитами, а также оценки механизма выдачи кредитов. И то же самое это повлияло и на Сбербанк. Ваш рынок ценных бумаг тоже, в общем-то, несколько, так сказать, поднялся. Он, в общем-то, довольно-таки низко упал, и он слишком дешев, но есть, тем не менее, причина для оптимизма. Он будет подниматься. И вот эти структуры фактически показали, что они очень устойчивы, и здоровы, и всегда есть возможность для дальнейшего развития, для работы с пенсиями, взаимными фондами, страхованием, долгосрочным депозитом, венчурным капиталом и так далее. Все это будет и будет работать в скором времени. И это дает нам, собственно, основу для оптимизма, потому что все это, конечно, такие вещи относительные, относительно легкие вещи, которые можно достигнуть. Поэтому я думаю, что очень много причин для оптимизма в этой стране.
Я попробую ответить как раз вот в рамках, собственно, названия на сессии про финансирование экономического роста. Я бы немного разделил ситуацию вот именно в российской финансовой системе и мировой финансовой системе.
Конечно, да.
С моей точки зрения, как раз российская финансовая система сейчас намного более потенциально готова для финансирования экономического роста. Хотя она по-прежнему остается достаточно однобокой. Конечно, гипертрофированный относительно вот просто по пропорциям банковский сектор и как бы небанковские институты по-прежнему остаются достаточно слабо развитыми. Здесь проблемы, наверное, даже не столько, собственно, в регулировании или создании инфраструктуры финансового рынка. Здесь прогресс за последний год достигнут большой. Сколько в институциональных реформах, структурных реформах. Ну, известно, как бы, то, что с точки зрения развития пенсионной системы мы, в общем, достаточно непоследовательно проводим. И, в общем-то, не очень понятно до сих пор, каково будущее ждет накопительную пенсионную систему, а это, очевидно, один из самых главных источников, именно как источников для формирования структуры длинных денег, даже если у нас нет никаких ограничений законодательных на деятельность, собственно, уже потом создания пенсионного фонда, которые могли бы эти деньги эффективно трансформировать. Поэтому, с моей точки зрения, российская финансовая система, она, в общем, хотя оставаясь до сих пор, не полной по объективным причинам из институциональных макроэкономических условий, но потенциально, как источник финансирования, трансформации сбережений в случае изменения макроэкономических условий, принятия реформ для новой модели экономического роста, в общем-то, если не готова, но в достаточно высокой степени готовности. А вот в отношении мировой финансовой системы, на самом деле, у меня в данном случае больше скептиса, поскольку, нельзя сказать, что мировая экономика, глобальная экономика окончательно преодолела последствия кризиса 2007-2009 года, и какая-то новая устойчивая модель экономического роста, новая, она сформирована. Но мне кажется, что все-таки те программы антикризисы, которые принимались во многих развитых странах, это в первую очередь программы количественного смягчения, реализованные в США и в Европе, они достаточно сильно, скажем так, сбили оценку риска и, в принципе, вот восприимчивость финансовых институтов к рискам после 2008 года. И вот, для перехода от инвестиций в крайне низкодоходные, но и надежные одновременно финансовые активы, которыми, в общем-то, значительная часть финансовых институтов занималась последние 5-7 лет. Переход снова к более активному работе с компаниями реального сектора, кредитованию, собственно, уже экономического роста и выход, соответственно, из этих программ, как работать с активом с более высокой стоимостью, как, мне кажется, в общем, может создать проблемы и, в общем, европейские, те же самые банковские системы, как вот мы видели недавно на примере Италии, в общем-то, находятся не в самой лучшей форме и здесь, несмотря на то, что с точки зрения полноты, естественно, глобальные финансовые системы значительно более представлены лучше, чем российская, они, как мне кажется, сейчас менее подготовлены для финансирования новой волны экономического роста. Спасибо.
Спасибо. Екатерина, я сейчас вам слово даю. Ну, так аудитории напоминаю, что рейтинговые агентства вообще тоже являются частью инфраструктуры финансового рынка.
Да, спасибо большое. Но я сначала об общем. Я уверена, что, наверное, я резюмирую то, что было сказано предыдущими спикерами, что инфраструктура финансовая у нас хорошая, но оказалось не в самом удачном месте, не в самых удачных обстоятельствах.
Отлично. Куда-нибудь ее перенести.
Да. Но что на самом деле дает и дополнительные возможности, потому что сразу хочу извиниться, что я опоздала, но я думаю, это иллюстрация как раз к нашей дискуссии, потому что заглохла машина, Но Яндекс.Такси и различные информационные агрегаторы, что тоже очень на самом деле полезно, или просто выход и голосование и попытка поймать машину очень помогает. Поэтому, несмотря на все препятствия, финансовая инфраструктура оказалась не в самых удачных обстоятельствах, не в самом удачном месте, но она работает. И вот продолжая линию, которую предложил предыдущий спикер, о том, чтобы поговорить о названии нашей сессии, я на самом деле ввела как бы небольшое как бы пространство между двумя словосочетаниями «финансовая структура» и «экономический рост». И вставила в название следующее, что на самом деле, с моей точки зрения, тоже отражает как бы взаимосвязь двух этих тем. Мне кажется, что финансовая инфраструктура – это обязательные условия обеспечения экономического роста. Но еще одна интерпретация того, что можно было бы вставить в эту фразу, что финансовая инфраструктура не является гарантом обеспечения этого экономического роста. И я думаю, что это на самом деле очень важно. И действительно, вот вы упомянули, что сейчас я возглавляю рейтинговое агентство, и в этой роли мы очень много общаемся с инвесторами и в России, и за рубежом. Иногда приходится просто заниматься ликбезом. И в частности, мне кажется, что очень важно то, чтобы все шаги, которые бы преследовали поднятие признания и понимания этих возможностей финансовой инфраструктуры, которые Россия предлагает. Потому что ну вот совсем недавно при беседе с очень крупным американским инвестором ну, хотелось бы перестать отвечать на вопросы наподобие «А в России как конвертируемый рубль или все еще нет?». Да, потому что, конечно, вот эти все клише, они очень сильно доминируют, и чего тут вообще про пенсионные накопления говорить? Поэтому, чтобы очень долго и много не говорить на эту тему, наверное, последнее, что хотелось бы сказать, это предостеречь от ненужных усложнений. Да? Вот креатива создания финансовой инфраструктуры, что все-таки должно финансовая инфраструктура, здесь я могу только приветствовать политику Центрального банка о том, чтобы все-таки ограничивать активность наших инвесторов в соответствии с их профессиональной подготовленностью на фондовом рынке, что все-таки степень развития финансовой инфраструктуры, вот этот финансовый инжиниринг не должен в значительной степени опережать спрос, который существует на рынке. То есть, опять-таки, возвращаясь к нашей теме, финансовая инфраструктура и экономический рост должны быть сбалансированы, чтобы ни то и ни иное не создавало перекосов, которые несут дополнительные риски для друг друга.
Mm-hmm. Спасибо. Ну, коротко. А, вот, кстати, мое общее мнение, сейчас не общее, вот, по тому, что было сказано, вообще участники дискуссии очень добрые. Они поставили российской инфраструктуре, ну и глобальной, в общем, тоже, где-то ну, четверку точно, по-моему. Так у меня впечатление. Вот. А вот мое личное мнение, я поставил тройку. Смотрите, ну, про российскую.
А мы двойку.
Ясно. Бывает. Кто меньше. Да? Смотрите, значит, я считаю, что есть два больших недостатка. Первое. Российская инфраструктура на самом деле не генерирует длинных денег. Это серьезная проблема. Действительно, она удерживает деньги в системе, это правильно. Деньги есть, но длинных денег мало. Второе. Имплементация риска не удовлетворительна. Но плохая. Это показывает просто опыт. Имплементация риска не очень хорошая. Ладно, вот такие слова использовать. Вот это два, наверное, самых крупных недостатка финансовой инфраструктуры именно с точки зрения ее главной функции обеспечивать экономический рост. Вот, давайте как бы на эту тему сейчас и поговорим. В принципе, у нас есть разделение пока все-таки отдельно банковские институты и небанковские финансовые институты. Причина в том, что, наверное, что мы так делим, потому что банки очень специфический институт, и все-таки банки не предназначены однозначно для финансирования долгосрочных проектов. У них много других очень важных функций, без которых или нарушения которых приводят просто к финансовому и затем экономическому коллапсу. Это относится ко всем банкам во всем мире. А небанковские финансовые институты, они в этом смысле более гибкие, они, кстати, больше адресованы вот на формирование длинных денег в экономике. Вот поэтому, может быть, мы так условно разделим. Вот. И я бы начал вот сначала с банков и поставил бы следующий вопрос. Смотрите, последние годы показали, что банки находятся в не очень счастливой ситуации. Их, конечно, хотелось бы куда-нибудь перенести, но некуда переносить, к сожалению. Вот, разве что на Луну. Вот. Во-первых, все-таки экономику глобальную потряс один очень крупный кризис, который привел к серьезному давлению на капитал с точки зрения реализации рисков. Второе, регуляторы на это откликнулись однозначно, они ужесточили регулирование, повысили существенно требования к капиталу, как минимум, плюс еще другие требования, Базеля 3, мы знаем, и Дод-Франк. Биль, который был реализован, это давление на маржу, на банковский капитал. И третье, развитие технологий цифровых. Появились альтернативные формы обслуживания банковского, которые как бы не несет нагрузки на капитал, такой, как создают регуляторы, но, как говорил Герман Греф, там забирает сначала завтрак, а потом уже и ланч у банков с точки зрения бизнеса. Вот банки вот в таком сегодня положении. Ну, дай бог, экономическая ситуация будет улучшаться и как-то, может быть, будет полегче. Но, тем не менее, вот мне кажется, что уместно задать вопрос в связи с этим, как изменится или не изменится роль банков в финансировании экономики. Вопрос очень общий, но вот эти факторы, они как-то приведут к изменениям вообще ландшафта банковской системы, или на самом деле ну, как-то банки выкрутятся, там, как вчера, по-моему, на банковской сессии говорили, ну, такой цифровой сессии, что банки все преодолеют, они там адаптируются, сделают нужные инвестиции и как бы останутся в том виде, в каком они существуют. Но только будут онлайн, если речь идет прежде всего о рознице. Вот давайте на эту тему коротко поговорим. Я бы эти вопросы адресовал, ну, скажем, Задорнову Михаилу Михайловичу, Горькову Сергею Николаевичу и вот, Сергею Анатольевичу тоже привлек бы для начала. А потом, если про глобальные банки говорить.
And if we speak about global banks, and if we speak about global banks, we speak about. Well, Mikhail Mikhailovich, let us start with you. Well, I'd like to express several ideas, and in fact, what is actually happening. Well, we're now in mid. January. In September, the shares of global banks cost 30% lower than today. Deutsche Bank shares cost 30% lower than today in January. And we understand that in September, the regulation, the infrastructure, nothing changed. And in fact, there were two events are the ideas of the American administration and the understanding of the next cycle. And the reassessment related to the American banks, and it also relates to the markets, bank markets, and all this occurred over the span of 4 months. So the situation is quite different today. And now, the perception of the banks and the market is quite different than in September. Secondly, certainly we cannot speak about a global market, banking market, well, as of something universal. Well, as a matter of fact, the American banks are working via nationalization, via very strict regulatory measures. They went through the number of measures, and their profitability is 9 to 10%, which in principle does not mean that they will go back to the year 2005-2006. Well, as a matter of fact, that was the golden age of the American banking. But Sergey is absolutely right saying that the European banks have difficulties to reach the figure of 7% with return on the capital. But at the same time, we've got to say that Russia is not really an exception, and we're speaking about, well, some 14, 15%, and we're taking blue chips. But you've got to remember inflation, and then we go back to the figure of 7% again. On the whole, the situation is not really a standard. It is quite unusual. There is optimism on the one hand, but the situation is very different depending on the sector. Well, against the background, we'll go back to Russia. In Russia, now we... we're speaking about the same technologies, digital technologies, and or moving away of banking services to telecom or some other specialized services. But I would not like to have the supposition traditional banking via branches and alternative services where we do not work with branches at all. Just all the world, just the same way as all the world, we're doing the same. Maybe we lag behind a little bit, but you can go for the mortgage loan to the branch. At the same time, you can use the internet and use the mobile bank, which is actually becoming more and more popular over the past 2 years. Well, mobile banking is actually something which is necessary and not maybe the very active channel. Naturally, banks will be moving towards the balance, which will allow the client to use several channels at once. And I think that this is the reason and the guarantee for the banks to adjust their business models and to live through this competition. Or what actually raises my optimism? Well, as a matter of fact, if we roughly assess the profit pool poll according to the results of the year 2015, well, with regard to reserves, well, in retail it was 1.5 trillion rubles. Well, in total that was 2% of the aggregate income in the banking system. So that is something which is not the main source of revenue, but that allows us to keep the clients. And in fact, the banks are earning money on something else. And I think that the situation is going to change in some 3 to 4 years. And perhaps the last thing I'd like to say is, well, let's say if we take just payments, well, 10 years in the Russian market, we could see the competition between payment agents, operators, terminals, and the banks. And I can say that if we take the year 2005, 2006, well, we could see that as of today, we had the redistribution of the market, and the banks won back its share in the payment market. And the share of banks in the online operations and in income is again quite huge, and it returned to the rating of the 2005-2006. Well, but that is not only with regard to transactions, it is also with regard to loans and for raising money for certain projects. But this, well, banks are not undertaking risk. They're preventing risk. They have only operational risk. Well, and here there is another interesting point, and maybe Sergey Nikolaevich will be speaking about that. You know what? I'd like to note that the financial structure infrastructure leads to economic growth. Well, but we are not speaking about economic growth. Ekaterina actually said that the infrastructure does not guarantee the economic growth. So we're speaking about accessibility of everything. So please, comments from the audience sometime later. So when we're speaking about the infrastructure, when we are saying that we have created a very good infrastructure, so well, as a matter of fact, we're transferring to the digital economy, but not yet. We're not using big data. We're using that to a very limited extent. So we've got to work with the infrastructure. But when we speak about the infrastructure, we're speaking about the retail. We are forgetting about aggregate issues, and we do not think about corporate clients. We're speaking mostly about our retail clients, but we'll see the same situation with regard to corporate clients. But the problem lies not in the infrastructure per se, but what lies behind this infrastructure. Because if this infrastructure does not resolve major problems, and the major problem is, in banks there is liquidity, but we do not have projects. There are two parameters which explain why we do not have projects. First of all, unwillingness to undertake a risk, and secondly, there is no long, cheap money. So if you create the structure which covers these issues, then I will resolve all other problems. Well, unless we have this, the system will not work. There will be no stimuli for the purpose.
So I hope that reduction of inflation will push down the interest rates, but even this will not be sufficient. There is no long money in the country, and there are no long money in the country, so we can build excellent digital bank, but without support of long money, this excellent digital bank will still operate with short money. Of course, it will handle two functions, but I once again support Ekaterina that it's not a mandatory condition because if we look back in Europe, the Russian internet banking is comparable and competitive with any big European bank, but the fundamental problem is not resolved. So good infrastructure is not sufficient for good economic growth. Sergey Anatolievich, still. Yeah. Alternative services arise for a reason. Mitigate risks differently. So, true that these alternative operators will become more and more active, and it will be an additional risk for a banking system. So do you think that regulators should look at this situation? Is it too early, or maybe it's already too late? Well, first of all, statistically, we can see that the duration of a banking project is by orders of magnitude is smaller than duration of the securities portfolio. So the payment of cost and salaries has an annual cycle. So within a year, you should earn enough to pay your staff. And there is no motivation to take a huge investment risks, because liquidity risk is the risk of the market, and the central bank taking various measures can help with the liquidity risk management, plus deposit insurance fund is also a kind of a guarantee against liquidity risks. So we're speaking more about interest risk. To raise the appetite for interest risks, bank should be put in a different position. G20, Basel III, and all the rest are not motivating credit institutions to create long money. If we look back on text books and our university classes, we will see that one of the key functions of the banks was to convert short money into long money. Today, the paradigm has changed, and everybody is saying, don't overburden the banks, and I can see that banks currently are unable to resolve for these tasks whatever hedging instruments we offer to them. In Europe, but less in the United States, and in our country, our task is to develop alternative transmission channels from those who have money to those who need money. Some of these tools are bonds and securities. In addition to retail customers, we have large companies who has excessive capital. Plus, let's say we work with rating agencies and external or auditors. I think that the top largest countries should not borrow from banks. So these, let's say, are two extreme categories. The middle should go to banks. Borrowers who has a very specific requirements, who need some customized approach, will go to the banks. But I think that, I would say, the smallest category of lenders and the largest category of lenders will turn more to securities. When you ask about the economic growth, I can say very simply, when let's say we allow banks to borrow operating funds from banks, not to keep them on the balance, we will create free money in the economy. And because banks are more tolerant to risk, because it's their business to take risks. As for equities, for us, it's, let's say, the best tool. It's the best instrument, and we have created the infrastructure that allows to buy and sell equity. But we need more information about corporate governance, about issuers of securities. But these are clearly understandable topics and duties. But I also mentioned the punishment for the abuse of office, because banks are usually joint stock companies governed by the board of directors. And if board of directors takes wrong decisions, worsening the financial situation for the shareholders and for the customers, such board of directors must bear the responsibility for their decisions. When we speak about the funding of economic growth, demand is really, let's say, the bottleneck, because we start from the from a businessman who is designing production lines and selling channels, and banks just follow the demand of the business. Yeah, but the situation must be reversed when banks take a different viewpoint. For example, I have a contract with a governmental agency or with any other corporation. I will be able to produce and sell products. But if I don't have this, let's say, selling contract, I will never get a loan from the bank, because everyone understands that today demand is the bottleneck, and demand is the driver for economic growth. So we have clear understanding about the export demand, but our domestic demand was not well analyzed and is not yet quite clear. To sum up a few words about digitalization, these are four factors. These are remote channels, and it's good because it increases accessibility. Country number one with SIM cards per capita is Russia. We have 36% of coverage with gadgets. Color TV is introducing dish and antennas with data exchange capabilities, so we'll have 100 internet coverage. Plus, digitalization allows the speedy decision making and documents processing. The third is the elimination of mediators. So we are creating business models where a mediator is ensuring contacts and takes a rather big margin. But also, now we have the analysts that does the same business analysis, but do not take decisions. So credit factory in the bank or credit factory in a B2B solution do exactly the same, but theoretically it works well. Practically, we and other countries just monitor the operation of such platforms, but we cannot say that we increase our risk appetite just installing such a platform. The operator of the platform must understand at least something about lending, borrowings, and risks. I personally doubt very much that these analytical problems replacing mediators will be of great success. Finally, what's mediation? Is the ability of a financial sector to work with small amounts, say small invoices and small bills, when it becomes profitable, just to communicate with every layman. So digitalization causes the acceptance of small funds. Small funds, small money is available from thousands of people. So it's the economy of scale, and it's the profit of scale. And some pessimistic views. Today and the last 15 years, we were relying on foreign money. And even during last year, the share of American owners of our money went just underwent some redistribution. 3 years ago, we understood that we should not put all our eggs into the same basket. We started even more active relations with China. We really not need long money, and in addition to retail lenders, we need other lenders. We have, let's say, already a bad experience, let's say, patching holes in 2008, and we were picking the funds whenever possible. Yeah, it was a multifaceted presentation. So the first that you said was that it's quite clear about retail business. Most probably it will be an online implementation. Identification of the risk and implementation of the risk does not cause problems. There are a lot of possibilities to do it properly. But if you don't want to do it properly, it's up to you. But and banks may find their place in this new situation. There might be some issues about regulation and supervision. Corporate business, of course, it cannot be exceptionally online, but risk assessment will remain the domain of professional experts and analysts. And I think that for everybody, for large and small companies, banks are of interest as the source of operational capital. And from my experience, the majority of borrowers were coming to get the circulating capital, and it was simpler from the viewpoint of
Alternative platform may also distribute risks, but the main thing is that if anyway, well, we ask a question, where is the long money? The money is with non-banking financial institutions, and we're going to speak about that too. But still, I want to give a chance to other participants to speak up and speak about those issues which we were discussing. And Sergey Anatolyevich said quite a lot about that, and I think that he explained the situation more or less. And if you have certain ideas, if you want to add something, I can give the floor. So very well then, the regulator has explained everything in a very good manner, and we can just say goodbye to each other. Well, well, as a matter of fact, when we speak about B2B platform, there are such popular banks in the United States, in Britain, so but they do not have a single successful project. They have startups, but they do not have a full-fledged project. Well, in Britain, they have such a project for 4 years, well, but they're not successful. Also in the United States, there is a scandal even there, and I have great doubts with regard to the following. If we see, well, the commercially profitable projects, then we can say that that is not just fashion, but that is actually something working. My question is, what about commercial bank? Is it the business which pays back? What do you think? Oh, well, it depends on how much reserve you create. So very well, we have certain regulations, well, from the central bank, well, and here is, what about Uber? Uber, do we all use Uber? Well, is it a commercial project, but it is not too profitable? What about Twitter? Well, Twitter, well, it is not really clear what to take money for. Well, as a matter of fact, for the advertising. Well, but anyway, we do have optimism. We can see something ahead of us. Well, it doesn't mean that people will earn something and then they leave. No, they will earn something and stay here in this country. Well, we do very well remember the period between 1999 and 2002 when, the company was writing a program, they came out with this program, and in Nasdaq they actually earned a lot of money, but investors lost and nobody got anything. So, as a matter of fact, if there are new technologies and they do not earn any money, well, I think that it'll be, well, a crash, just the same way as it happened previously. So if you have at least half of the money which works and earns, and the other half doesn't, well, then if the system does not have such working money, well, then the system will end in a crash. Oh, well, I will not speak about Uber. Well, I like Klaus, but, well, I do not really understand why do you take so little money in a competitive struggle? Well, I'm sorry, I started speaking, well, without permission, actually, but, well, I think that, well, labor should be compensated for. Well, we used to think that for the volume, then for the shareholder, then for equity, investment capital, for something else. Well, there are quite a lot of models, maybe dozens and dozens. Well, a whole basket, Mr. Vyugin says. Well, but quite a lot of things indicate that, well, that is something that when the company is losing market share, they show better return on their capital. Well, with regard to the volumes, well, they're developing quite well. And, well, certain projects are not profitable, but investors are getting money on it, and investors are commercial banks. And commercial banks are getting stable revenue. So from the point of view of commercial reinvestment, well, as a matter of fact, they are remind of fictitious companies, well, like providers of gas and electricity. Well, they do not have any prospects for growth, but anyway, they have stable revenue. Well, here we've got to admit that the regulatory factor has become a black swan, as a matter of fact, because in reality, well, proceeding from the situation which we have now in Europe with regard to a whole number of European banks, investors have difficulties to understand what is happening. You know, the disclosure of information in the developed markets is of low quality, just the same in the same manner as in our country 10 years ago. Well, investor, when buys a share somewhere in the market, does not really understand what is happening and what kind of share it is. The bank may be fined for this. So, investors, it turns out that investors must have some insider knowledge. So, that is a contradiction. No new information will actually affect the price. But insider information might actually affect the price in quite an unexpected manner. And the European markets see such a situation now, and banking regulation is of an extreme importance now. If there is data trading, such things might happen. If we speak about long-term funds, which hold the position for 3 to 5 years, or we speak about pensioners who will buy some shares, certainly this swing factor is very contradicting. So this happens once in 20 years when I disagree with Alexei in something. I tend to think that regulation is a response to the new risks. And what is happening to the European banks, what Alexei was speaking about, is that we all reconsidered what can actually happen to banks when there are certain external shocks, as in 2008. So that is actually a response to identified new risks, not vice versa. Well, let us not speak about that and not argue about that. I'd like to add something else. Well, Sergey said that a limitation to the development of the projects, and most participants understand this, that is the limitation of demand. And the demand is not sufficient, and we do not really yet come out to the external markets. We do not have the demand there. But as for the old scheme of saturation, that is something which is gone. We've got to form new consumer demand, and we've got to do that, but we've got to introduce new products. Uber is not successful. Well, Uber is 4 years old, but it doesn't work exactly the way we want it. So, and the Russian system does not actually support such new projects. We've got to think about new risks and about the new quality of risk. So far, we have not yet created a structure for venture financing and for risk financing at large. When we speak about banks, we're saying, oh, where is our profitability, where is our portfolio, where are our risks? And the system does not support new technological projects. It does not support innovation. As for, let's say, electric kettles or TV sets, the saturation is really high. But to introduce some new projects, we see some failures. So that is why we've got to adapt the system for new products. Well, I think that in the world economy, it's quite the same. If the system does not get adjusted to the new conditions, there will be one model. If it does adjust, the principle will be different. Well, at least that is the way now. Very well, then.
let me just comment very briefly on a couple of points that you've made. One is what foreign capital is going to be available for the kind of long-term money that we've all been talking about to develop this economy. It will not arrive from the banks because the banks have been so damaged by first 2008, then a very completely out of proportion regulatory response, particularly from the Americans, and the Americans have. Let us put it this way. It is remarkable how the Americans have disproportionately awarded punishment to European banks compared with their own banks. And so the European banking industry is bombed back to the Stone Age. It's going to stay there, I think. There is long-term capital dying to deploy itself. There are huge amounts of long-term capital looking for a place to go. Kevin Rudd yesterday was talking about the superannuation funds in Australia, which have done every possible long-term project in Australia, so they're looking elsewhere. Ditto in Chile, ditto in Canada, ditto in the UK, because the bond market's on the floor, so they want long-term projects. And I think as far as Russia is concerned, it becomes a presentation problem, because all these funds want nice, safe projects, long-term projects in the middle of England or in Saskatchewan. But for instance, the Mexicans are trying to represent themselves because they need long-term capital for airports and so on and so forth, just as you do. And it becomes a presentational problem. And I happen to think that the development bank is probably the key to this, if this can be. The Mexicans are using Bancomext, which is roughly your equivalent, Sergey, as a kind of guarantor, a kind of guide into the market to remove some of the long-term risk.
May I ask you to keep microphone a little bit closer?
Sorry.
Just to.
That implies people might like to hear what I'm saying. You flatter me. But I think this is possible, and the ingredient, while you are building your own long-term capital, which you will, it takes 15 or 20 years to bring your long-term capital to international standards. I don't presume to advise, but I would suggest that's the case. But I think via a larger and more active and more heavily capitalized development bank, there are probably ways of drawing in this long-term capital through a kind of representation of the risk and the projects. You're looking at me. I've spoken enough. I will stop. But thank you very much.
Thank you. Спасибо большое. Ну, я так понял, что
I think that it is high time to move away from banks and devote the rest of our time to non-banking issues. The discussion itself leads us to that. With banks, everything is clear. The banks will remain risk takers. They will digitalize, and in many ways, the new technology is going to change the banks. But practice shows that long money is not so much in the bank, but in some other places. Yesterday at the plenary session with the participation of the Prime Minister, Kevin Rudd, former Prime Minister of Australia, well, shared his interesting views. There was a question about Australia. Australia is a country which has a trend towards resource development and using resources as the background of the economy. Well, but he said, well, yes, that is our illness, our disease, the Dutch disease. Well, we were trying to deregulate the economy. We started attracting young, capable migrants. And the third thing which we did was to introduce the requirement that every person in Australia, every citizen, is obligated to save 9% of his or her income. And Australia is actually number four country which transfers its long-term money for management. Well, in Russia, we were trying to redistribute this money. But in Australia, somehow, they do have quite a lot of long money, more than enough, but they're using it. So, and now, what are the institutions? What are the institutions of asset management? Well, a non-state pension fund and insurance business, where the reserves are also formed into stable long money. But a general question to everybody, and that is a question to all the participants. What do you think? What is the obstacle for Russia, for the Russian economy to form a serious and powerful sector of non-banking institutions which would accumulate long money? So there are economic reasons, well, general economic, regulatory reasons, political reasons. Well, could you somehow speak about that? Very well. Well, who is the first to start? So development institutions. Well, we as an institute of development will have to face this problem because we did not have long money. Well, before that, we existed as a commercial bank, and using, well, borrowed money, well, of Western funds, so we invested it into Russian economy until it was possible. Well, but then this mechanism broke and it became impossible. Well, somehow there is no long money in the Russian economy, and I think that we'll have to resolve this issue not in just one way, but in quite a lot of methods. Well, but our country is bigger than Australia, and the population is bigger. But anyway, we are similar sort of. And by the way, we can take a look at Brazil. And Brazil has a very similar economy and the population. And the degree of innovation technologies is not too high. But somehow they managed to export up to 300 technologies, we managed to export only 35 to 40 new technologies and superjet. Well, so how did they manage to resolve their issues? Well, they have a certain savings, and I think. You know, the reason people do not trust the ruble deposits. So when we speak about long money, and I think that all the speakers agreed with that, we're actually discussing the issue of the changing culture of investment. And we do not want any forced decisions. I think that one of the answers to the question of where is long money and why we have so little long money, I think that we need a certain period of growth for the purpose. Even if we compare this country to Australia, we'll see that in Australia they worked for quite a long time for it. And whatever regulatory changes they had, they had certain stability. Well, what the social model of the state, which we continue to develop, has certain negative consequences. We forget about certain terms, countercyclic regulation, for instance. We forget such concepts as moral hazards, which is translated into Russian as моральный ущерб. And also the wrong undertaking of risk. And the greater participation of state in the economy. The attitude of the people who are thinking, well, why should I be choosing between iPhone and my pension? People hope for the state to help them, and the degree of responsibility, personal responsibility, goes down. It is really very important to determine the values and the consequences. So there is a certain unpredictability of decision taking. We have difficulties in the development of pension system and insurance system. We also spoke about profitability, and I'd like to dwell on this. Certainly the investor wants to have profitability. And I think that the world financial crisis have not yet come to an end. And the main underlying reason for it is the underdeveloped real sector of the economy. We spoke about venture capital and venture projects, and we're developing the project for introducing methodology for assessing securitized structures. And we're trying to somehow get certain progress in this particular issue. But we also have quite a lot of projects with a certain aspect of risk and venture. But people do not really trust the state. The people are unwilling to show the actual profitability of the project. Alexey Vladimirovich spoke about the logics of management in a government company. And their logic of behavior is quite distorted. And whatever stimuli we create for the development of debt market via the stock market, how can we offer an investor a certain acceptable profitability? We've got to think about the level of compensation, because mostly this level of compensation for the investment is not enough, is not sufficient. I spoke in a rather fragmentary manner about that. But we've got to discuss it. And long money. As for the long money, we used to think about it that it is foreign money, and that is the wrong approach. It is interesting to study the experience of Japan. So no matter how difficult the situation was in Japan, nothing fell. still they're developing, and the corporations are keeping the system under control, and they struggle the liquidity risk. So I think that, we are trying to do everything to attract foreign investment, but we do not manage to do that always. But we forget about the work with the national investor. We forget about studying the manner of behavior of the Russian investor. We forget about trust to our local investor. So we've got to remember about corporate governance and introducing a lot of various stimuli for investment into priority projects. So that is all very important. And though over the past several years, the development of the world economy showed that a private person as an economic subject is not very rational, well, no matter what Adam Smith says about that, very often we go from one extreme to another. And if we create good conditions for the rational behavior of a physical person, he will respond to it. But now I cannot really claim for being a very advanced person in this issue. But anyway, even at the everyday life level, we've got to have a possibility to prove the necessity to invest money into certain sectors. Why do people invest into real estate? Because that is quite understandable, and the profit is understandable. Well, I'm speaking a lot about psychology, but real estate, that is an asset that is feasible, and you have a feeling that you control it, and the dynamics is not bad at all. You can let your apartment, for instance, and you can control it. As for the pension savings, taking into account the Soviet history and the post-Soviet period, certainly there is a very vague understanding of the situation. And unless we overcome this, I do not think that there will be shifts in the perception. And if we speak about long money, we should not expect quick decisions. Well, but we've got to work on it. Dear colleagues, we have just a couple of minutes. Each of you can use a couple of minutes to come out with your final comments.
So just a couple of footnotes, actually. The first is related to bank stability. I think that the issue of this discussion is very interesting. But I think that we take as given the fact that for financial markets to be a positive factor to economic growth, financial markets do not have to amplify unwarrantedly shocks that may affect the economy. And so one thing that I would say first is that maybe we have to take into consideration that policies should be applied, and in this sense, I think that both Central Bank and Minister of Finance deserve great recognition, is that this economy was hit by two strong shocks in 2014, and bank stability was actually preserved. And this means that these shocks that could have been very greatly amplified and absolutely affecting negatively growth actually were avoided. The second thing that I would say is also to focus on economic growth. We did a little study with some colleagues and comparing Russia with peer countries, namely countries in Eastern Europe and Central Asia, and, countries in the BRICS group, of course, excluding Russia. And what we found, and using a category of analysis that we call financial development, what we find is that if Russia is able to increase basically the size of its financial markets, and this was widely discussed by the experts on the stage, that there is still insufficient development of mutual funds, pension funds, insurance companies, and Russia compares actually quite poorly with in terms of size, not necessarily on regulation, but in terms of size with countries, peer countries. If Russia is able to actually go to the frontier in these areas, there is a potential gain up to 1% of GDP growth per year. And so in a context in which I think it's very clear that everyone agrees that the elements that form the Russian growth model during the first decade of the 2000s are exhausted and that there is needed to find alternative sources of growth, I mean, adding 1% of growth per year actually sounds quite attractive. So with that, I would stop, and thanks very much for the invitation.
Well, I would also like to thank everybody for inviting me here. It's a great pleasure. At random, let me pick up on a couple of points. One, Alexey brought up the question of venture capital briefly, and I think that's probably the thing we've not talked about to a great extent. And frankly, this is a worry for every country in the world except one. It's not just a question of Russia, it's a question for every country in the world. Why is it that more than 50% of the world's venture capital is deployed in the United States, and all the rest of us have to put up with the remaining 35 or 40%? And so it's not that the Americans are that clever about producing advanced companies and new companies. It's just that they throw more money at it than the rest of us put together. So that's a very complex question. I mean, there are related questions of why, since Tsarist times, Russia has exported its young entrepreneurs to a large degree, and we can discuss why that is. But it applies to my country, it applies to throughout Europe, it applies to Asia. Why is it that we are not somehow and I don't have the answer, why are we not producing this venture capital industry? The Americans produced it by government intervention, Small Business Administration, and things like that. The Americans love to pretend that they're a free market economy. They're not. They just hide it better than the rest of us. And I'm basically clueless how we get the venture capital question going, but it's crucial to my home country as it is to yours.
Once again, I'd like to speak very briefly about long money. Well, I think that there are three main factors. The first factor is the level of inflation, and moreover, the level of inflation expectations, and proceeding from the volatility of expectation, we mostly see short money. And until we change the attitude and we do not have long money, people will be investing into short term instrument. Then the second issue is the level of the income of the population. The average income and the average wages can be comparable to other countries. But if we take a look at the median level of Russia and Australia, let's say, then we'll see that in Russia there is nothing to save. Actually, for the category of wealthy population, we can see uncertainty with regard to the pension reform, and people are not willing to invest into some other instruments. They're mostly investing into real estate. For even a wealthier category, they are pushing out the money abroad and then bringing back the money to the country. And the fourth aspect with regard to the development of the insurance market. So that is a lack of understanding of economic benefits of insurance. Let's say Sago and all those instruments which should become the basis for investment, voluntary investment, And the development of insurance market is actually perceived as money lost or some taxes which are pressed upon the population. So the voluntary insurance is not developed at all. With regard to the differentiation of income, so that is an issue to be discussed, well, and the issue of pension savings is particularly essential. Well, everything is so distorted, and the level of compensation really needs some very well-developed approach. Well, in fact, we do not have more time, well, fortunately or unfortunately, I don't know. But I'd like to thank everybody, all the participants in the discussion, for their contribution, and it was interesting for me, and I hope that the audience liked it.